In the name of one God, creator, redeemer, and sustainer. Amen. He was so zealous for the things of God that Jesus couldn't contain his anger over how far off base the people had strayed. This morning's gospel does not portray the sweet Jesus that we can keep contained in a little box to be opened on Sunday mornings and then put back on the shelf for another week. No, Jesus can be fierce. The passage about how Jesus cleansed the temple by making a whip of cords and turning over the tables of the money changers is found in all four gospels. In the synoptic gospels, that is in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the story is placed just before Jesus' arrest and trial, making it the virtual last straw that angered the authorities. In John's gospel, this story is placed at the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, where it points to Jesus as a reformer of the faith. When I hear about this event, I feel bad for the poor money changers. After all, they were just doing their job, providing a service to the pilgrims seeking to worship on temple grounds. Many would have come from far away, especially for the Passover, and they would need to purchase clean, unblemished animals for the sacrifice. They would need to pay for them using the correct coins. You see, the denarii and the drachmas and the other coins of this time had either pagan symbols or imperial portraits engraved on them. And so they couldn't be used inside the temple grounds. But Jesus turned over their tables and shouted, "Get these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." Instead of a place of prayer, set apart for time with God, Jesus saw that the ritual sacrifice and all of its procedures and business had become the main focus, not just for the money changers, but for the priests and the pilgrims as well. It might be easier to handle this wild, prophetic Jesus when he's safely consigned to history, or when we see him dishing it out to those people over there. But can we imagine if someone came into Zion and acted in this way? Would we accept such behavior? Of course not. We would immediately call the police. But Jesus' words are for our instruction as well as for the folks way back in the first century. And so we should be asking ourselves, where is our focus when we think about church? Is church somewhere where we go to receive goods and services that we expect? Or is it a place from which we are sent? How does the business and the busyness of church help or hinder our relationship with God and Christ? And for that matter, what is church and what is it for? When Jesus initially spoke with these astonished witnesses to his actions in the temple, he referred to his Father's house. That is the place of prayer where he had studied and discussed scripture with the elders when he was just a boy, the place he came regularly with pilgrims from Nazareth. The temple was the center of the Jewish world, and it was the center of their world because it contained the Holy of Holies, the real presence of God. Being Jewish, Jesus knew that animal sacrifice was taught as the way to offer something to God, to show one's love and obedience, and to atone for sins and to get right with God. But Jesus turned the tables on that whole system, clearing out this old way of relating to God. He was frustrated with the temple because he saw that by placing so much focus on these practices, the people were missing out on God. As early as the prophet Hosea, the voice of God had proclaimed, "For I desire mercy, not sacrifice, and acknowledgement of God rather than burnt offerings." And Jesus was going even further than Hosea here. When asked what sign he could give them to justify his appalling actions, Jesus said, "Tear this temple down, and in 3 days I will rebuild it." Well, this didn't exactly clear things up, and they had no clue what he was talking about. At least, not until after the resurrection, when they realized that he was talking about his own body being the temple. If he had said this more clearly, Jesus would have been immediately arrested for blasphemy. His body, the sacred place of God's presence. Jesus was declaring that God was fully present to him in his own body, the divine presence within him. I'm reminded of the description of church by author Annie Dillard. On the whole, she wrote, "I do not find Christians, outside of the catacombs, sufficiently sensible of conditions. Does anyone have the foggiest idea what sort of power we so blithely invoke? Or, as I suspect, does no one believe a word of it? The churches are children playing on the floor with their chemistry sets, mixing up a batch of TNT to kill a Sunday morning. It is madness to wear ladies' hats to church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews." I'm reminded of this because on the night before he died, Jesus took bread and told his disciples, "Take, eat, this is my body." At our baptisms, we become part and parcel of the body of Christ. Each week, we are nourished by his body and blood. We take in what we are to become. As the body of Christ, we too become the temple of God's Spirit. In his first letter to the people of Corinth, the Apostle Paul says, "Don't you know? Hasn't anyone told you? You yourselves are God's temple, and God's Spirit lives in you." As important as our practices and traditions and the business and busyness of Zion may be, these are not the main thing that we are to be about. The season of Lent calls us to get back to the heart of the matter, to put our focus on God, who is among us and within us. And so we gather as the body of Christ to worship God in community and to listen for God's Spirit to inspire us before sending us out. In Christ's name, I invite you to join me now in a few minutes of silent prayer.